The Bible says in Jeremiah 29:11 that God has plans of good for us and not of evil to give us what? A future and a hope. So God's talking about good sometimes is in the context of the future. What Jeremiah also refers to as an expected end. Now let's pick up from there today and let's go to Ecclesiastes chapter 7 verse 8. Ecclesiastes chapter 7 verse 8. Ecclesiastes 7 verse 8. Are you in Ecclesiastes 7, 8? The end of a thing is better than its beginning. The patient in spirit is better than the proud in spirit. As a matter of fact, you could take this passage and go right down all the way through to about verse 11. But notice what it says there in verse 8, the first part. The end of a thing is better than its beginning. Will you say that with me? Would you say it again? Now, this is God's declaration. God says, I am more concerned about the end of a thing because it's more important how a matter is concluded than how it is commenced. God is more concerned about the end of a matter than he is about the beginning. And this is why God never judges people on the basis of their past. Have you noticed that we judge people about what, on the basis of what we know about them, where they've been in their past? But God, on the other hand, judges people on the basis of their future. Tell your neighbor he's focused on your future. Let me show you another passage very quickly. Isaiah chapter 46. Isaiah 46, we're going to read verses 9 to 11. Isaiah 46, verses 9 to 11. Remember the former things of old, for I am God and there is no other. I am God and there is none like me, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand and I will do all my pleasure. Calling a bird of prey from the east, the man who executes my counsel from a far country. Indeed, I have spoken it, I will also bring it to pass. I have proposed it, I will also do it. Can I focus on the first part of verse 10? The Bible says God declares what? The end from where? The beginning. Ladies and gentlemen, God never starts anything at the beginning. Hello? God never starts anything at the beginning. God always starts at the end. The Bible says he declares the end from the beginning. If I wanted to commence a project, I will start my project at the beginning and I will finish it at the end. If I was going to write a book, I will start my book on page 1. And then I will write the whole of chapter 1 and then go to chapter 2 and 3 and 4 and then come to the end of my book. But guess what? When God wants to write a book, he writes page 289. And then he writes page 250, and then page 200, and then page 100. And then he comes to the beginning of the book. When he sees the end, and notice what he said about the end, it is an expected end. It is a good end, not an evil end. And when God has concluded and nailed down, firmly fixed the end, he now says to the beginning, you may begin. Hallelujah. Let me tell you the beauty of that. Nothing happens to you by chance or by accident. Hallelujah. Tell your neighbor you're a finished work. The Bible says before your days were started in Psalm 139, God had written the diary of your days in his book before they even had their commencement. You see, so your life is not an accident. God is not making up your story as it's going along. He has finished the issue of your life. There is a conclusion in the heart of God that nothing, absolutely nothing can change. As a matter of fact, let me show you this. God never starts anything that he has not finished. And that's why God has no unfinished projects. Because everything that God commences, he has already finished. So the fact that you are alive today is proof that God has concluded the story of your life. Tell your neighbor, I'm a conclusion. I'm not a question mark. I'm not a dot, dot, dot. I'm a conclusion. You are a conclusion in God. The Bible says he declares the end from the beginning. He has settled the matter of your life. Let's go to another verse in the Bible. Come with me now to the book of Habakkuk. In the book of Habakkuk, we see a dialogue between Habakkuk and God, which sometimes reflects the sort of dialogue that we have with God, either verbally or otherwise. Now, let's first look at chapter 1 and read a few verses there, and then go to chapter 2. Chapter 1 of Habakkuk, verses 2 to 4. Oh Lord, how long shall I cry and you will not hear? Even cry out to you violence and you will not save. Why do you show me iniquity and cause me to see trouble? For plundering and violence are before me. There is strife and contention arises. Therefore the law is powerless and justice never goes forth. For the wicked surround the righteous, therefore perverse judgment proceeds. Now look at the answer God gives him in verse 5. Look among the nations and watch. Be utterly astounded, for I will work a work in your days which you will not believe though it were told you. Praise the name of the Lord. Now, there engages a dialogue between Habakkuk and God. We will not go into the details of that. But in chapter 2, Habakkuk has finished asking God a question. And in verse 1 of chapter 2, he says, I'm going to now stand and hear what you will say to me. Or even if you want to rebuke me, you can do so. Now, look at God's answer in verse 2 of chapter 2. Are you in Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 2? Then the Lord answered me and said, write the vision and make it plain on tablets, that he may run who reads it. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it will speak and will not lie. Though it tarries, wait for it, because it will surely come, it will not tarry. Hallelujah. What is God saying to Habakkuk? God's saying, look, Habakkuk, I have a plan, I have a purpose, I have a vision. You can as well write this thing down and make it plain, because it's going to happen. Hallelujah. God is saying, write my vision for your life upon the tablet of your heart and let it excite you. Let it make you happy. In the midst of your problems, in the midst of your difficulties, stop looking at where you are today. Go to the end of the matter and write that on your heart and let that make you leap for joy. And then God said, the vision is for an appointed time. Can I suggest to you that there is an appointed time for God's vision for your life? Somebody say appointed time. Appointed time. Say it again.